in Syria. But it's obviously, you know, an extension of that research. The book does continue into the uprising of the Civil War. And in fact, I have left some flyers for the book that allow you to get the book 50% off. So hopefully this talk will inspire you to learn more about the Syrian theater. In the early days of the Syrian uprising, theater practitioners were prominent in organizing the Damascus opposition to an escalating government crackdown. As the uprising gathered steam, theater practitioners were prominent in the creative resistance movement, filling the Arab media scape with oppositional plays, puppet shows, and video blogs. Okay. Well, I can just use it.
Okay.
Now, in the midst of civil war, theater practitioners are working with the victims of government violence and devised pieces that give aesthetic shape to traumatic experience. Some of these works juxtapose diverse wartime experiences and responses to trauma, interspersing the verbatim with the fictional. Such work aims to restore volition. Refugees become artists, demonstrating the ability to make use of their past experience, at the same time that the combination of voices demonstrates different responses to war. The playing space becomes an open discursive field in which varied understandings of the self become platforms for new understandings of the nation. In the process, these artist refugees trouble the boundaries between the private and the public, potentially creating a new public sphere that is not only revolutionary in its critique of entrenched political power, but in its reformulation of the idea of the public itself. These therapeutic theater projects extend work which is being done in the years prior to 2011, the start of the uprising, and build on a long tradition of Syrian political theater. Applied theater, an umbrella term designating performance venues that performance that is valued as efficacious as well as aesthetic, has had a brief and difficult history in Syria. As an art form committed to social and personal analysis in public forums, it has run afoul of state efforts to police the public sphere. Omar Abusada, prominent in Syria's applied theater movement before the uprising, is now creating therapeutic productions with Syrian refugees. And tonight I will talk about his 2013 production, The Trojan Women, which was performed by Syrian female refugees in war. I do so as to explore therapeutic's potential to help in the healing of individual and national identities. In its content, Abusada's The Trojan Women implicitly critiques the state's unfettered violence against its citizenry. In its format, the work more broadly questions the formation and regulation of the public sphere. It asks both who gets to speak to the common good and what constitutes the common in the common good. It does so by forcing its audience to rethink the boundaries of the public. The play, in effect, asks, can the personal reflections of female refugees, their observations on a work of ancient literature, recollections of cherished worldly memories, the descriptions of violence, their experience of forced migration, can these become the means of redefining national identity? The potential for imagining social structure is implicit in therapeutic theater, which helps participants, both actors and the audience, to process past trauma through acts of creation and sharing. This sharing distinguishes therapeutic theater from traditional trauma therapy. Trauma therapy is a private activity, as Robert Landy and Michael Montgomery explained. They're both professors at NYU. That's why it's important to go to this way. In trauma therapy, quote, the clients within the therapeutic process are both the performers and the audience. By contrast, in therapeutic theater, actors take control of painful memories by transforming these memories into raw material for art as art that exists to be shared. The audience for Therapeutic Theatre includes family, friends, and any stranger who has been touched or is at least interested in the originating trauma and its theatrical process. Since the goal is to fashion trauma into art, the therapeutic process is only complete after a run of a public performance. Making the private public is the final step in an artistic therapeutic process. It is also a political act. At its most basic form, all drama therapy relies on the mind's tendency to use metaphor to process traumatic experience, in the same way that Freud argued that the mind converts painful experiences into manageable tropes. Drama therapy provides participants with the tools to construct images and stories through which participants can access and manage past trauma. In this sense, drama therapy can be described as displacement in reverse, whereby images retrieve rather than sublimate the past. Through projective identification and dramatic distancing, drama therapy participants create new stories that incorporate past experience, inoculating the artist patient against the corrosive effects of trauma. Drama therapy is a project of creative remembering, a remembering that psychoanalysis posits at the heart of healing. In drama therapy, a therapist, often called a facilitator or a leader, helps one or more clients create healing stories in private settings. Therapeutic theater, by extension, pushes this work outwards into a public performance for a community that shares this trauma at some level, though they did not participate in the rehearsal process. Now, before addressing Omar Abisada's work, this production of The Church of Women, it is useful to situate his work in a tradition of political theater. In using theater to open up spaces of resistance, debate, and healing, Omar Abisada continues a tradition of political theater at least as old as the Assad regime. And that is the subject of the book. While previous Syrian regimes employed censorship, surveillance, political detention, and torture, none did so on the scale of the governments of Hafez al-Assad, who came to power in 1970 in an intra-party coup. Nonetheless, under Assad, a generation of theater makers came of age responsible for some of the most openly political and probing theater in the Arab world. Over the past 50 years, the very best Syrian theater has engaged in forbidden topics, critiquing the government's use of surveillance and incidents and torture, analyzing Arab-Israeli relations, drawing attention to Arab oppression of Palestinians, debating how ideas, history, and heritage have been employed to serve the state, and even problematizing such loaded concepts as martyrdom. The young practitioners whose theater engages in uprising and the conditions of the Civil War follow in the path of such directors as Naila El-Atrash, who's here with us, Awaleed El-Kuwaiti, Gwalti, Fawaz El-Sahar, and playwrights such as Sibella Williams, who grew up with Muhammad Al-Mahmoud, who made the theater a privileged site for social and political examination. Omar Abisada's recent work and the techniques he employs gives insight into the connections between this current generation of theater makers creating work in the midst of civil war and a previous generation that created work under oppressive rule. It's not simply that Omar Abisada's generation trained under El-Atrash, Kowalti, and Sahir, and studied the plays of Yunus, Adwan, and Mahmoud. More significantly, this generation inherited a society in which the theater was the only space of public assembly outside of the mosque in which speech was not strictly scripted by the state. While the drama therapy and form techniques that Omar Abisada and others employ are relatively new to Syria, these practitioners are grounded in an understanding of theater and social change that developed over decades. It is a complicated history, but a few important elements can be summarized here. State-supported theater flourished during Syria's alliance with the Soviet Union, an alliance that grew especially close under Hafez al-Assad once he came to power in 1970. The National Theater began a touring model in that same year, bringing productions in cities and villages, and whether or not they have a physical theater. Similarly, the Syrian military ran its own theater with a touring wing. The state also established several regional theaters. All of this follows, you know, the Soviet policy of using theater to advance state policy, both through workers' clubs and military arms and the like. More significantly, Syria began sending practitioners to Eastern Bloc countries for training. Many of these practitioners not only created theater, but taught at the High Institute for Theatrical Art in Damascus. Fawaz Asakhar studied directing at the Russian Institute of Theater Arts and taught at the Damascus Institute from 78 to 83. He founded an independent theater company with Sabella Windows, which included a lead of Kuralti. He himself had studied at the National Academy for Theater and Film Arts in Sofia, Bulgaria. Kuralti taught at the Institute from 79 to 92, serving as director from 91 to 92. At Sofia, Kuralti studied alongside Naila, who taught at the High Institute from 78 to 2001 and served as the director of the acting program from 1989 to 1991, and then again from 1995 to 2001, when she was dismissed from her post by the Order of the Ministry of Culture. More on that later in the paper. Other directors who taught at the High Institute also studied in Eastern Bloc countries like Hassan Milti, Sharif Shakir, Fawad al-Rashid, and Najash Sarab. So really, there was this entire generation of theater makers trained in Eastern Bloc countries who were, you know, essentially training the generation, which right now is leading the uprising and creating theater work in the midst of the Civil War. And so this idea of the political efficacy of theater is deeply a part of the recent history of Syria. These theater makers and teachers spent the better part of their careers pressing against the boundaries of permissible speech. They brought to Syria from their studies in countries like Sofia, East Berlin, and Moscow, an understanding that theater is a bodily art, and that metaphor and irony can transform a seemingly neutral gesture into a pointed critique. They have seen their work banned in the middle of rehearsals and on opening night. They have submitted the same works to censors multiple times under different titles in the hopes, sometimes successfully, of getting permission to approve banned work. And they have used current events to shame the Ministry of Culture into allowing productions of banned works. In some ways, their students grew or bear. Omar Afsada studied under Naila and Melita Kuralti at the High Institute. And even as a student, he insistently used theater spaces, including a conservatory, to advance his political positions. In 2001, at the height of the Al-Aqsa Intifada in Palestine, Abu Saleh, like many Syrians, was growing impatient with the refusal of the government of Bashar al-Assad to endorse Palestinian self-rule and come out in support of the Intifada. Assad's position reflected Syria's long-standing animosity to the PLO and his wish to avoid provoking Israel, especially when a renewal of talks on the Golan seemed possible. In response, and so, you know, of course, Syria has constantly announced itself the defender of Palestinian rights, and here in the midst of the Intifada, the government was silent and was not even allowing demonstrations in support of the Palestinians. So in response to this, of course, this was a huge contradiction and a hypocrisy that angered a great many Syrians at this time, though no one actually felt empowered to say that this was a contradiction, except for theater students. Abu Saleh organized roughly 15 students to sit silently in the lobby of the Theater Institute before signs proclaiming their support for the Intifada. So nothing that critiqued the state, it simply said, you know, I support the Intifada, and a couple of them sat. Students arriving at class joined them, and by the end of the day, he had organized a general strike. While such an action might not go prompt government action in the U.S., and I imagine it's unlikely that the Secretary of Defense would fly to Juilliard because some students refused to go to class, it quickly came to the attention of the Minister of Culture, Baha Kanut, who personally came to the office of Madame Atrash to insist that she order the students to disband. When Atrash refused, she was soon visited by a general in the Mahabharats in the secret services, who reiterated the demand. Under this pressure, Atrash convinced the students to hold their strike in the courtyard before the institute. 2 months later, Atrash was dismissed from her post and banned from teaching in Syria. In response, Awasada took a group of 66 students to the Ministry of Culture, requesting a meeting with the Ministry of Culture. When they were rebuffed, the students simply stood in front of the Ministry of Culture, returning each morning for the next 15 days. They only stopped this when the students' families started receiving threats from the secret police. The sit-in and subsequent dismissal of Atrash was reported in the Lebanese paper, As-Safir. The Syrian papers simply announced her dismissal without noting the context. Awasada returned to Bilal. So after graduates, this is the kind of person he was when he was at the Institute. On graduating, he turned to Augusto Bilal's foreign theater techniques. In 2004, he founded the Studio Theater with other recent graduates and some current students. Working under the auspices of the United Nations Population Fund, and with logistical support from the Syrian-controlled NGO Firdos, Fund for Integrated Rural Development of Syria, Awasada's company, the Studio Theater, began staging workshops and productions in the countryside outside Kanaitra, Idlib, Homs, Latakia, and Aleppo, all places, incidentally, that are the core of the uprising now. Their theater work addressed polygamy, marital relations, women in poverty, and literacy. While the support of an NGO might seem antithetical to Syria, the Syrian government's strict attempts at controlling public space, such efforts fall under a governance strategy that Stephen Haven has termed, quote, upgraded authoritarianism. Writing in 2007, Haven argued that in response to a growing pressure for greater civil liberties, several Arab governments had attempted to co-opt the rhetoric and structure of the civil society movement, creating domestic NGOs visibly led by the regime, visibly led by regime elites, but lacking any autonomy. Such NGOs could be used to exclude or control Western-financed NGOs in Syria. So in Syria, for example, the president's wife was the official sponsor of the nation's 7 major domestic NGOs, all of which were centralized within the Syrian Trust for Development. So, of course, the government announced, we are totally behind the rise of NGOs and the civil society movement. Look at it, we own 7 of them. And in fact, anytime another NGO wanted to do anything in Syria, they had to partner with one of these existing NGOs, essentially giving over all control of the project to the Syrian government. Awasada's company clearly stretched the level of public speech that the Assad regime was prepared to accept. So on the face of it, doing theater projects with children in villages may not have seemed so potentially dangerous. In the first stage, a small troupe of Studio Theater Company members spent a minimum of 3 days a week in a single village over 3 months. During that time, through repeated theater games with separate groups of children and young adults, the company researched village beliefs and opinions and paved the way for additional collaborations. A theater game might begin with a simple question such as, quote, what was the most beautiful moment of your life? The questions and answers would ultimately lead to the creation of stage pictures, which would be followed by discussion and analysis. This paved the way for more complex questions such as, what was your most difficult experience in your family, or your school, or your workplace? Ultimately, the groups shaped these pictures, these stage pictures, into simple drama. These and other theater games served to familiarize participants with the experience of self-examination, debate, and envisioning alternate possibilities, all in a public forum. And these are villages, by the way, that don't even have a coffee shop. I mean, there is no public space in these villages. And so, you know, creating a theater in a patch of open grass, effectively, is, for many of these young people, their first experience of public space. In the second stage, the rest of the studio theater joined the group and began to draft an original script, drawing on the research of a smaller group, eventually performing an open text for the village. This performance incorporated Augusto Boal's Joker character, a kind of master of ceremonies who encourages audience members to intervene in the narrative and even replace actors. The Joker also summarizes the solutions the audience has proposed. The first phase not only identifies appropriate ways of addressing issues in the village, this phase also trains a critical mass of audience members who then feel able to debate and intervene in public settings. Such foreign theater projects fundamentally undermine a central strategy of the Saud regime and the ruling Ba'ath Party, the Ba'athification of the public sphere. The selective tolerance of foreign NGOs, combined with their mandatory partnering with local NGOs that are actually arms of the government, was a means of channeling civil society forces into implicit support for the regime. Foreign theater, with its emphasis on spontaneity, repeated questioning, communal scripting threatens to disrupt this stage management of society. Not surprisingly, Firdos withdrew its support, ending the project despite the United Nations Population Fund's desire to continue. With the state limiting studio theater's ability to pursue foreign theater projects, the group turned to drama therapy and therapeutic theater. In May of 2008, the company developed a theater piece entitled Sama, or Tolerance, with the inmates of the Khalid ibn al-Wahid Juvenile Detention Center. Criminals in Syria are tried at the age of 11. Children are tried at the age of 11 as adults, and they can serve long jail time for things like petty theft. The project was initiated by the Italian NGO Movimondo with financial support from UNICEF. And Movimondo trained Abu Sada and his troupe, Studio Theater, in working with troubled juveniles and secured permission for their performance from the Ministry of Social Affairs. The children generated the material for Tolerance, writing about personal experiences and taking part in theater games. They first performed in the detention center, but eventually transferred the piece to an independent theater venue, El Teatro. There, they worked in masks to preserve their anonymity due to the stigma of imprisonment in Syria. The project was specifically framed as rehabilitation as opposed to the more dangerous project of individual or social development. And this is the program with the seal of the Ministry of Culture on top, and you can see that the student, the performers are intentionally blurred to create an independence. I don't know if you can quite make it out, but here at the bottom, for the rehabilitation of juvenile offenders and to raise awareness with interactive theater. So again, it's constantly spotlighting this not as a kind of civil society gesture, but rather as an action of rehabilitation. After the state saw what they did, though, they were once again denied permission to pursue these kinds of projects any further. The Civil War has, of course, entirely disrupted regular theatrical activity, but it has created opportunities for theater practitioners to work free of normal scrutiny. In 2012, Abu Sada directed Mohammed Al-Attar's Please Look Into a Camera, a play that was developed out of testimonies of those who were detained and tortured during the uprising. I just mentioned that the playwright, Al-Attar, was a member of Studio Theater, this company that was doing foreign theater projects, and he actually had gone and trained at an applied theater program at Goldsmith University in London, got a master's in applied theater. The play began as a verbatim piece, but over multiple drafts, Mohammed Al-Attar edited and reshaped the interviews, situating them within a fictional story about an amateur director named Nora,
who was filming a documentary about the uprising. Abu Saada and his cast rehearsed the play secretly in Damascus before taking it to Seoul for a two-week run in April, followed by a one-night performance in Beirut at the Sunflower Theater. As in playback theater, performing an individual story valorizes that experience and opens up points of discussion for the community. In this case, the refugee community in Beirut, and those who offered their testimonials, the people who offered their testimonies had traveled to Beirut to watch this performance of their words with other members of the refugee community in Beirut at this theater. And they're seeing their own experience of torture being described. But the verbatim pieces have been crafted so as to explore the problem of national identity in the aftermath of torture, which is a repeated question that comes up in these verbatim passages. Oh, incidentally, the play has been translated into English and is in the current issue of TDR. Lisa Levine translated it, the noted political scientist. So, in 2013, Abu Saada began working with Syrian refugees on a revised piece based on Euripides' The Trojan Winter. In that production, the development process privileged the performers grappling with their own personal experiences through the medium of Euripides' play, rather than focused on the play text. Only a small portion of Euripides' play is actually performed, and there is little effort to convey the play's narrative. Instead, the group uses passages of the play to prompt reflection on their own experiences. The 28 women who performed determined the content of the production. The staging choices elevated the actors' personal experience over Euripides' text. Speeches of characters were confined to video projections. Half the screen showed a woman facing the camera, the other half a woman in profile. The woman facing the camera began by identifying herself and stating her age, and then explained which character she most liked and how that character resembled her. So the woman on the left, for example, explains that Hecuba's sense of loss becomes an occasion. Becomes an occasion for the actor on the left to say, 17 years ago, I too desired death, and felt that a taste of bitterness would linger in my mouth to the end of my days, no matter how long I lived. However, she explains, that changed with the great joy that entered her life, namely her children and her husband. Then, the woman in profile delivers several of Hecuba's lines, in which the character describes the horror of seeing her husband cut down before her. So, the lines of Hecuba's, of the tragedy that, first of all, she begins, it doesn't begin with Hecuba. It begins with a character remarking on Hecuba, not to explain her current displacement, but to explain how bereft she had felt before in the past, and how now, because of the support of her family, she feels herself to have a reason for living. And so it denies the Euripides' text the power of determining the meaning of these women's experience. Instead, they have the freedom to shape that text, to use that text to reflect however they wish to on the lives that they have. The first actor is given the privilege of facing the camera, defines herself in relation to the play text, and the play text that follows serves to clarify that self. And of course, it's important that it follows. First, I tell you what Hecuba means to me. Only then are you given a taste of Hecuba's language. In this manner, the audience encounters Hecuba, Cassandra, and Andromache as illustrations of the performer's memories and self-observations. In other projected segments, women discuss the city of Troy as a spur to their own memories of Syria. Starting out, I imagine Troy looks like this, and they'll go on at great length, and it will bring them back to, of course, it couldn't, as beautiful as it was, it couldn't compare to Damascus. And then they describe their Damascus. Or comment on their favorite lines relating these lines to moments in the past. These projected segments alternate between loss and joyful memories, but they largely focus on life before the Civil War. By contrast, the live performance grapples with the trauma of flight from a war zone and the dislocation of life as a refugee. These painful recollections are interspersed with brief choral odes from the play that, ironically, come as something of a relief, as a relief from the pain manifest on the stage as the refugees relate, sometimes with visible duress, their stories of their flight. So you get these choral odes that are really the performance of objection, and you experience them as a release from the painful experience of watching a middle-aged woman confront her experiences in the last month and kind of garner the strength to repeat them before an audience. A middle-aged woman sits stilly, hands on her lap, speaking into a microphone, describing crossing back into Syria on learning that her mother had descended into a coma. So the woman gets a phone call, she learns that her mother is in a coma, she convinces her husband to let her leave, she leaves, she goes to Amman. Days after her mother's death, she recounts masked men breaking into the house, throwing her young nephews onto the floor and threatening to kill them. First, they're after her brother. And if she tries, when the brother refuses to go, and the brother says, kill me here, this is my land, I'll die here, they throw the children on the floor and threaten to kill them, and then they drag the brother off when he finally agrees. She's getting calls from her husband telling her she needs to come home, the children are asking about her. She leaves even though her mother has died, she leaves even though her brother's whereabouts are still unknown. She describes crossing back into Jordan and later receiving the phone call from her sister. Muhammad is dead. How? Don't know. The Red Cross found him in the street. The bullet entered from his mouth. She concludes that her remaining brothers went to the hospital to identify the body and then brought it home for the burial. And the thing that is most powerful about this, I get the call from Damascus. About how long is it going to go on? I'm going to go.
Spoke
to my husband.
3 days later, my
mother dies.
بعد 10 ايام من وفاة امي اتصل بي جوزي قال يطلع لاولاد الحارة وحبيبكم. قلت له يومين ثلاثة بينزل. قام قال لي اخي مين اللي عم يحكي معاكي؟ قلت له جوزي عم بيقول لي يطلع مشان الاولاد. قال لي شو قلت له؟ قلت له يومين ثلاثة بطلع. قال لي معناته اليوم بتحس انه عندي ليلة ومشتاق بشوفك. ونمت عنده.
So they're sleeping and she's with the children, the brothers in another room.
15 masked men
burst.
قام طلعوا كلهم ومشوا، كانوا هن نازلين من عصفور وفاتحين البوابه الاساسيه اللي من برا.
قاموا
قالوا له دغري مشي معنا، قال له وين بده يروح؟ قالوا له مشي معنا ولا كلمه.
قام
خيي رجع فات على البيت وقعد بالارض وقعد يظبط بشعره. قاموا قالوا له قوم روح معنا وجهوا السلاح عليه، قالوا له قوم روح معنا. أنا مخيّة أرضني أنا بأرضي هون. أنا ما أقدر معاكم ولا على أي مطرح.
I don't care.
قلنا نحن صرنا
نتسلسل.
أما قالونا بشكل على الحيط. كل الكل. وجهوا علينا السلاح. واللي بيرفع صوته ما نوشه. قاموا جابوا ولاد اثنين وحطوهم بالأرض. واحد عمره 17 سنة وواحد عمره 8 سنين. والصغير فيديوم مريض ومعامرة بالسرطان وعامل له عملية براسه. قاموا حطوهم اثنين بالأرض وقاموا اثنين وجهوا عليهم سلاح وسياج. قال له إذا ما بتكون معانا هلا هلا بمشي ولادك قدامك. قام قال لهم خلوا سيبوا ولادي وأنا بستعد روح معاكم وين ما بدكم. بس ولادي لا.
The father saying, "Take me, take me. Just leave the children behind."
I'm free, Mama. Ma, I don't have to pay for the rent. And the world is like a day of March. I want the house to be all ceramic and winter. Free, he's coming. I'm free.
She
said about how they fell in the woods. It's raining, it's muddy, it's cold. وحتى ما خلوا لا يلبس بإجره ولا يلبس على جسمه.
Here he's talking about how they dragged him out. He's
طلعوه وكان معاهم دم سيجار.
It's cold night.
وسحبوا حالهم ومشوا. قام اتصل فيه جوزي وقال لي اطلع. قلت له محمد انخطف ومش عم نعرف مين اللي اخذه. قال لي فكر على الله يا مرة اطلعي ما بصير غير اللي الله كاتبه. سحبت حالي انا بعد من خطفه بثلاث ايام طاقت. بعد اسبوع من خطفه بتتصل فيي اختي من الشام.
بتقلي
محمد مات.
بتقلي
كيف مات؟
How did he die?
بتقلي ما بعرف. لقوا الصليب الأحمر بالطريق.
The Red Cross found him in the street.
لقوا الصليب الأحمر بالطريق ومقوصين وطموا جابتينه. وأخذوه على المستشفى.
They took him to the hospital.
بس كيف ما
But how he got out of
قاموا راحوا أختي على المستشفى تعرفوا على الجثة.
The rest of the family goes to find him in the hospital.
قاموا راحوا أختي جابوه من المستشفى على البيت. أخذوه من البيت ودفنوه.
The juxtaposition of linguistic registers renders these memories all the more immediate. The speech of the characters and the choral odes are delivered in classical Arabic with rhythmic delivery, a language that is used in prints and official representations but isn't normally spoken. By contrast, the live reminiscences are delivered in the Syrian dialect, a language of the everyday. The pauses and ellipses, the apparent effort of human frailty, the effect of human frailty rather than a performance choice. The choral odes are performed with group stylized movement or tableau staging. In the reminiscences, a single woman sits before a microphone. The artistry of the staging in Euripides' text rendered the stillness of the reminiscences that follow much more immediate, further underscoring its status as real as opposed to theatrical. As much of the stories of atrocities grab our attention, the production is careful to present them as one way of remembering the past. A woman might also reflect on a line of Hecuba by using it as a springboard to a childhood memory of life as a tomboy and being mistaken for a boy, as the case of the woman on the left. Or lines about smoldering Troy prompt a memory of a class trip to a museum in Tartus, most beautiful moment in a young woman's life, as the woman on the right explains. The complexity and different experiences of life as refugees is emphasized in the production's closing sequence. 8 different women come forward to read letters they have composed to loved ones far away. A mother congratulates her daughter on her recent wedding, and only the mother's delivery betrays her pain of being absent. A woman writes to her aunt, relating her joy on being reunited with her son, who was separated from her during flight. The performance ends with a young woman who has written her mother about the stress relocation has put on her marriage. The remarkable honesty of this last letter reveals a courage equal to, though entirely different from, that of the woman who narrates during her brother's death. The project, when gathered, is productive of the courage it traumatized. Abu Sada's reimagining of the Greek chorus is the most innovative component of the production. Euripides' chorus serves to further illustrate the reduced state of the main characters, and at times to embody the loss of self in unrestrained lamentation that the named characters approach but never fully engage. Omar Abu Sada's staging carefully skirts the boundaries of such abjection, and this is central to the work's therapeutic value. The opening moments of the show feature a crowd of veiled women backlit against a bright screen, so that they appear only in silhouette. They speak different texts simultaneously, their voices growing louder in an incomprehensible din as they walk downstage towards the audience. Only after a lighting change that makes their faces visible do they begin to chant in unison an ode revealing the fear of the Trojan women at becoming the chattel of an army and subject to the licentious desire of the Greeks. Their voices ascending in pitch. Oops. This is the opening moment of the production. And then at this point they would start to chant Euripides' text in unison. In the next prologue, the clumped women silently mouth words while an unseen speaker recites. The speaker only becomes visible at the end of the ode. One by one, her companions have broken off from the group, leaving her alone. There's also a choral ode that follows the story of the Vega massacre, which is recited in darkness, while the narrator, the person who had experienced the massacre, remains silent but visible in a small circle of light. The chorus begins with a droning hum that grows louder and segues into a brief lamentation for the destruction. Humming precedes a later choral ode as well, this time increasing in pitch until it breaks off in a cry followed by the lament, "God has forsaken us." The women then lift their hands and cover their mouths as they deliver the ode rapidly, as if ululating at a funeral, lamenting the destruction of their poor city. Abu Sada's performance choices accentuate the tension between the rhythmic and orderly language of Euripides' choral odes, as translated into classical Arabic, and the dramatic context of the odes. These characters are terrified of what awaits them, horrified by what they have witnessed. Their reduced state is made manifest in a performance style in which language threatens to spill into mere vocalized pain. However, the character's tenuous control of language is juxtaposed against the actor's self-possession.
as evident in stylized production choices that signal rather than manifest abjection. So while the language, if Euripides' language, is this powerful lament for the destruction and loss of life, the performers are very distant from the emotional content of the prologue, as demonstrated through these highly formal acting choices. In short, stylization quarantines the performer against the objection she represents. In the process, Abusada works against both the eloquence of Euripides' text and its potential to subsume the performer in its own emotionalism. The Trojan women production evokes images of objection, but then holds them at arm's length. The act of distanced conjuring demonstrates that the performer is greater than her recent history, and this gives the performance its power. It is not simply that Euripides' text in Arabic is moving, it is. However, even more impactful is the knowledge that this performer, who has mastered the text and the physical choices that frame and provide shape to the loss of self-possession, may have herself experienced similarly harrowing events. See, she would seem to proclaim, such events can destroy a person. However, I have chosen to make theater. The first-person narratives, the most direct and unmediated expression of trauma, are themselves stories rather than lamentations. The speaker transforms her past experience through narrative, and in doing so, masters them. If there is a dramatic tension for the audience, it is akin to what one experiences when watching an acrobat perform. One does not wonder how the feat will end, but marvels that it can be successfully completed. Every pause, every repeated word or seeming omission heightens audience members' attention and their hopes for the performer's success. As an example of therapeutic theater, the Trojan Women brings a wounded community closer and moves both performers and audiences toward healing. The show was mounted in Amman for two nights in December 2013 for an audience who had all been impacted by the war. The families of the 28 performers, other refugees, aid workers, and Jordanians, who are doubtlessly affected by the presence of nearly 600,000 registered refugees in their country. Probably the show would mean something very different mounted outside of the region. It is not an idle speculation. In October of this year, the performers were flown to Geneva where they remounted the show. Performances were planned for New York City and Washington, D.C. this September, last September, but were canceled at the last minute when the state couldn't get the visas. In Amman, the production was an instrument of communal healing, but in Geneva, there it may instead have raised awareness of the humanitarian crisis and mobilized action. Whether this is the ultimate goal, it is the case that the British producers of the show had international audiences, or perhaps international donors in mind, when they commissioned a documentary on the making of the production. The documentary is called Queens of Syria. On their webpage, they have announced that they will present the film in venues ranging from camps to gala screenings and film festivals. And in fact, in October, the film premiered at the Abu Dhabi Festival last October, and right now, or rather later this evening, it's being screened in Stockholm. A production invariably achieves multiple ends, whether it be drama therapy in an institutional setting or a musical extravaganza on Broadway. However, no end can be achieved without funding. When Brecht chastens artists who made the mistake of, quote, imagining they had got hold of an apparatus which in fact had got hold of them, it's not because he advocated a theater free of financial concerns. Rather, he insisted that artists confront the business of theater so as to be better aware of how it affected their artistic output. When British producers of the Trojan Women selected a Western canonical text for production by refugees, they may have exercised such clear thinking. The selection no doubt made it easier for them to raise the £75,000 needed for a production. With that relatively modest sum, they were able to provide the performers with food and travel subsidies, provide daycare for their children, and provide psychological counseling for all of the actor performers. The producers of the Trojan Women are moving forward with additional projects targeting multiple audiences. Refugees, of course, but also a larger Jordanian audience, as well as Syrians, and an expanded international group that extends beyond donors. The producers are currently raising funds in partnership with UN Women for additional drama therapy workshops and a therapeutic theater piece in the Zaatari refugee camp. They have also created an audio serial written and produced by Syrian refugees examining the effects of the refugee crisis. They are streaming it online on an online radio station called Soria Lee, which is a pun because Soria Lee means both my Syria and also sounds like Surili, which is the word for surrealism. Such projects grow more necessary by the day, even as the scope of tragedy threatens to overwhelm the will to respond. The death toll in Syria is approaching 200,000. 3 million Syrians were refugees, and nearly half of all Syrians have been displaced. An entire generation of children is growing up without a functioning nation, displaced to cities that cannot absorb their families or in bordering countries. The violence of the Assad regime and the even more horrific brutality of ISIS have made a democratic Syria a distant possibility. Still, theater makers continue working with refugees to make sense of personal trauma. Others reflect on their own experience of nation, creating work in exile, and posting it online. To understand this impulse to creative resistance and creative healing is to understand how theater can remain relevant in an age of atrocities. Thank you. One of the people I talk about in the paper, Nyla Latrosh, is here with us. And actually, I wonder, well, I was going to field some questions, and I suspect, I don't know, I mean, many of the questions, I suspect Nyla will have the more interesting answer. Hang out there, and then I will just ask for your help as it's needed, because I didn't really warn you that I might do this to you. But are there questions? Yeah, Anthony?
I was just curious, the idea of therapeutic theater, is that something that is particular to Syria, or is that something that manifests itself in other
places? Here I have to turn to my colleague, Jennifer Cruz, who's an international authority on applied theater. If you trace it all the way back to psychodrama, which was developed in the 1960s, early 70s? 1970, I thought.
Well, Moreno?
Yeah, Moreno's 1970.
Before that, yeah.
Before
that,
early, yeah. Much earlier than
50s, maybe.
50s, okay. So, the whole idea of using theatrical activities in a therapy setting date back to the 1950s. There are different techniques that have been developed both by psychiatry as well as by theater practitioners. So this is, an ongoing and very rich history. What's new is the use of these practices in the Arab world, principally because Arab regimes have systematically refused the entry of NGOs into their country. And so it was only been in recent years that countries like, simply for different reasons, it's only happened recently in Lebanon, but Syria, Lebanon, Egypt, there are now actually active applied theater program activities going on. There's theater in prisons, there's theater with the victims of trauma. It's really in the last 5 years become a really vital field throughout the Arab world. But it's a very old, it's not a recent development outside of the Arab world.
Yeah.
To Claire, thank you very much.
Sure.
It's two questions. One is clarification, and one is another more specific one. In the pieces that you showed, the women start as this chorus, and you explain very clearly the facial frontage and then the profile. Do they break from this chorus and then do this?
So I didn't go into quite so much detail about this. There's a screen at the back of the stage, and there are projections that happen on the screen, and then there are live performances that happen in the space. And there would be a name would appear on the screen, Hecuba, in Arabic. And then the next shot would be of the two women, and you'd hear the and it would alternate between personal reflections where someone is generally still before a microphone, and forelodes. And the forelodes are all staged in different ways.
So another part of that same question before I get to the second question is the participants were willing to be filmed. Was this a problem, or this was not something that they had an issue with at all?
No, well, I mean, first of all, it's a self-selecting group. I mean, it's interesting. First, it is, in fact, a conservative group of women. Most of these women came from Dara, which is where the uprising began. A large percentage of the women came from Dara, where the uprising began. But it's also an extremely conservative Sunni village. And you can see that the women are, by and large, veiled. A couple of women wear the niqab. Part of that is, the costume design. But I also, I actually didn't ask Omar this question, but I imagine part of it is at the preference of the performers.
Well, I did ask him.
Oh, you did? Okay, please.
Nanda, who was training the
actors.
Woman.
Yeah.
A number of young women were not veiled.
Yeah.
But they adopted the veil in the performance as a costume.
Right. So some of the performers didn't want to wear veils and don't wear veils. And some of the performers do wear veils. And they made a costume design choice to veil everyone.
But the filming, again, was not a problem. This is also
I'm sorry. Yes, there was a problem in filming them, of course.
Okay.
Oh, of course. Some of them didn't accept to be.
Yeah, 50 women started in the project, and the project was completed with 28 women. And so some people dropped out of it. For whatever reason. Having said that, this group is clearly comfortable with it. They created a documentary called Queens of Syria, which is great. And these women, traveled. And there was The Guardian. It's interesting. This was covered. This performance was covered in The Guardian. There was a short article in the Wall Street Journal. And one of the things that those articles both stressed was this idea of women from conservative households, quote, having to nag their husbands into letting them do the show. Whether or not that is accurate for the cross-section in this production, it's clearly the case that the Western media presented this as women from who have this life-changing experience with drama, who come from conservative homes and have had to kind of petition their husbands for permission to perform.
And that leads me then to the second question, really. And that is a comment that you made, as a theater practitioner as well. Obviously, there are the theories of public performance. But you made some comments about taking therapy to public performance. And I would just like you to clarify in terms of this experience, because obviously they're doing testimonial theater. I'm not a therapist, drama therapy person, but rather the issue is this is testimony theater, this is political theater. So, from coming from the other side. So what was the line that you were trying to address as to who or what theories say that the therapy should go, or was that more tongue-in-cheek? Because obviously it was therapy, but it went for public performance to
right.
the community.
Right. Well, I one of the points I want to make is that the you know, making personal therapy a public act is a highly political act, because it says that the experiences of these individuals are part of the common good. And that processing these experiences are important not only for the individuals, but for the community. So it's a kind of redefinition of who gets to draw the parameters of the public. So I certainly didn't mean to say that it was therapeutic instead of being political. Having said that, the women did make a conscious decision not to talk about the assault issue. You know, there's no moment where anyone talks about specific leaders or specific policies. Even the passage about Muhammad being taken off by men in masks, there's never any explanation or any suppositions to who these people are.
Interesting. Yeah, an observation and a question. You're reminding me in hearing, I missed the beginning, I was teaching, I would never.
In what I heard,
you said first the studio theater was doing forum theater, and then they shifted to therapeutic. And of course, that's what happened with Boal too.
Right.
He had first done forum theater, and then as he would try to find what are subjects people wanted to do in different certain parts of the world, when he left Latin America,
yeah.
people would say, "Well, my issue is loneliness. My issue is alienation." And he felt that people were much more talking about the way they had internalized the political. Depression.
Yeah.
And so he just thought it, he used to call it the other side of the coin. So it's kind of interesting
right.
hearing here too, going from forum to therapeutic. But then in terms of when therapeutic started, I mean, again, if we look at Boal, then he drew so much on what were the popular forms of expression that already existed. And even forum, he would talk about people in Latin America going forum, forum. I mean, it existed already.
Right.
And then he added his own, you know, ingenuity to it, but it existed. And I'm thinking of how much storytelling, when a group of people get together and tell stories, which is going on forever, that's therapeutic.
Yeah.
So at what point we want to, so I don't know how we would ever even say when this starts.
Yeah, I think all acts of theater exist on a continuum, and not just a continuum. It's not just like, well, is it aesthetic or is it efficacious? Is it personal or is it public? I mean, it's this huge constellation. And you know, as scholars, we create these categories because we need the categories to make sense of the varied activities, to be able to describe the varied activities. But they really are arbitrary categorizations.
But I guess so then my question had to do with, were there popular forms of performance that I wanted
to,
maybe you talked about that already.
Sure.
So
No, I didn't. So popular performance forms. So, you know, every marriage celebration would often hire an individual to do a kind of call and response or poetic recitation about the guests. There used to be, the oral epics, it used to be very common anytime you had an important family event, a marriage, or specific holidays, to hire an oral storyteller who would recount maybe the Sirah Beni Halal over the course of several weeks, and that would become part of the new standard performance. That's much less common now. Now, part of the reason that these kinds of performances are much less common is because of things like synthesizers. People have a wedding and they hire some guy to play on a synthesizer as opposed to hiring somebody on a qanun to sing the Syrian Beni Halal. And in fact, when you go to a wedding and there are these kinds of old performance traditions, often it's very wealthy people kind of enacting their cultural heritage. It's less common now among the class where it would be associated with. Krista Salamanca, a wonderful book called The New Old Damascus, recounts people going to the Sheraton
where they had set up like food stalls, like old Damascus, where you could walk around the lobby, you know, the big ballroom, the Sheraton, and sample local cuisine in people in traditional costumes, as opposed to just going to the old city where the stuff actually was. So there's a very kind of complicated play of nostalgia and the relationship between history and heritage that is playing out in Syria through performance, right? The epic oral storytelling, the individual who would sit in a coffee shop and read from a great book, the stories of Alvo or something from A Thousand and One Nights, it's more or less dying out, but it still exists, I don't know if it still exists. As of 2010, which is the last time I was in Syria, it existed in Damascus. But it was, the coffee shop was filled with tourists, and kind of wealthy, educated Syrians going for a taste of their history. These kinds of traditional forms then get taken up in the 70s and 80s by theater practitioners who, influenced by Brecht, are bringing popular entertainment forms into the proscenium theater. And there's all this talk of a truly Arab theater that will engage people. Not just in Syria, it happens in Egypt, in Morocco, the Masrek Tifaliya, festival theater is premised on the idea of turning theater into a kind of public ceremony. So it was a big movement in the 70s and 80s. But there as well, the traditional is being framed within is being kind of framed and presented for an urban educated class.
Thank you. I'm just curious, is there any place, either to date or perhaps in the future, where the nagging husbands, who are also refugees, where are they?
I know a lot of theater projects for children. I know of theater projects for women. I don't know of theater projects for men. This did not begin as an all-female theater production. It was only because women were interested in taking part. It's a really important question. And I don't know, I suspect that there's a certain amount of resistance on the part of men. Many men continue to cross back, many people who are in refugee camps continue to cross back into Syria as fighters or as workers, even though they've found a place for their families outside of Syria.
If I might, what's really striking me is, and here a cross-cultural, that here in the United States, it's a general remark, it's not that there are pockets of it, but the absence of a theater that's generated from veterans.
Yeah.
I would say it's not that it doesn't exist. And of course, knowing that it's both men and women as veterans. But how drama therapy, and here I'm not a specialist in that area, but the degree to which I'm aware of the general absence of theater of witness, perhaps comparable to refugees, veterans themselves who are engaged in performative occasions. It seems to be a global in that regard.
And I would guess that all of the things that stunt its development here, it's just tenfold in the Arab world.
Yeah.
That would be my guess. You had a question?
Yeah, thank you so much for this. Is it possible that you could tell more about these women? Who are these women? What did they do before the civil war in Daraa? And what are their religious and ethnic identities? What they do in Jordan right now? Are they teachers, for example, or do they work in a way with the refugees?
Well, so I know virtually nothing about these women other than what they report in these videos, in the clips. I mean, what I have is the raw footage of the performance, which was given to me by Omar. That really is the material from which this was cobbled together, this presentation was cobbled together. But what they do say about themselves is these were students, these are people who recently completed their studies. Most of them are married with children. Some of them only having recently finished their education. The mothers stay at home with their children, did in Damascus, and continue to do that in Jordan.
I mean, I'm really curious about why they chose to participate in this, because you said that they are a self-selecting group.
Yeah.
Being from there, I can imagine that they are anti-regime. And even if they decided not to talk about the Assad regime, I mean, this looks like to me like political performance of their opposition to the regime. I mean, they don't have to talk about the regime. I'm just talking about their experiences like this, the First Amendment.
Well, they're obviously not regime supporters. They fled. Which is not to say that, you know, supporters of the regime aren't part of the displaced, but they're not displaced outside of Syria. They're displaced to the homes of family in Baltaki or Damascus. They're not, you know. So yes, you're right. They are part of the. They are families that you know hate the assault regime.
I wanted to say that my interpretation is that this sounds like political performance of their opposition to the regime.
Yeah. I mean, it you're absolutely right that. I mean, again, the thing that I would just mention is that a piece about the Trojan women could be a piece about tyranny. It could be about political power. And while there are, you know, the description of being forced at gunpoint in the middle of the night into, you know, cold, freezing rain is terrifying. The work never turns into agitprop. It never calls for certain actions. It never names perpetrators. It always returns to the experience of the speaker. But I, you're absolutely right. I don't mean to. It would be wildly inaccurate to say this is apolitical work. It's deeply political.
Yeah, I worked with Syrian refugee teachers in Turkey for a year.
I see.
So, I mean, mostly those teachers, they were anti-regime, and they were really scared about talking about the regime, still, they were like...
I mean, it's an incredibly courageous thing to...
Yeah, it is really courageous.
And it's an incredibly courageous thing to, you know, to allow yourself to be filmed.
Yes.
Especially when you obviously have family still in Damascus.
Mm-hmm.
Most of Syria is anti-regime.
Yeah, I mean, even the fact that they allowed to be filmed, I mean, I think that shows that they are revolutionary.
Yeah.
Because usually revolutionary Syrians, they are the most brave, and they are not, I mean,
well,
they
and the other, thing, the other thing is that, I mean, obviously, the recent experiences are politicizing. I mean, how can, even if you refuse to claim the place of claim that political voice, how after forced migration, and how after this process of exploring your experiences, could you not, you know, feel empowered or feel responsible for claiming a certain political agency? The thing I would say about them is none of these women were paid. The organizers actually wanted to provide salaries, and Omar felt that this was going to be a mistake because they were going to be
flood of people interested for salaries. And instead, what they made, he insisted, was that they be given travel subsidies, food subsidies, psychological counseling. So essentially, they were given services. But none of these people came. He did mention that once the word got out that there were all these subsidies, then the list of people who wanted to participate suddenly tripled. By that time, the project was up and running.
Clarify something and then ask a question that maybe all this will come first and chance. The first commentary I wanted to make is that to the extent that this is based on Boal's work.
Could you just speak up a little bit?
Sorry, to the extent that this is based on Boal's work or informed by it, the idea that you would have a theater that's therapeutic on the one hand and political on another, or that these are on opposite ends, the scheme wouldn't work at all.
Yeah.
That his work is I don't know to what extent he would have used the word therapy at all, but
therapeutic.
I don't know that's that language that really is at work there. But it's called theater of the oppressed.
Yeah.
The act of telling one's story publicly is a political act. It's about speaking back to the structures of oppression that have silenced you, sort of by definition. But I'm so curious by this idea of. You know, you framed it as an act of therapeutic theater, but I'm so curious about this idea that the director was also advocating for services that would involve therapy. Do you have any more to say about the range of the language that's been thought of here in terms of the different kinds of efficacies of coping, healing, that are being used by the like how he's thinking about that, and obviously he thinks there's something very productive and good and valuable for the women to tell these stories and participate in this. But what is he taking care of?
Well, I guess the first thing I would just note, and this I get more from my conversations with the individual who was overseeing the. There's a wonderful scholar, dramaturg at Syria named Marie Elias. She was responsible for coordinating studio theater's work in Knaiyot and all these different areas. And when I talked to her, she explained to me in some detail just the tremendous obstacles that had to be overcome. Because I asked her, I said, well, so you know, what if you don't have support by an NGO? The kids are doing this for free. I mean, why don't you just go do it? And she said, you don't understand. You don't understand the obstacle of getting a child to leave the home and come and tell a story with other children to a stranger. And she says, well, you've got to understand, these are towns where the only space of congregation is the mosque. It's houses and the mosque. And so I took from that for this group of actors, you know, for Mahad Masada, there really was this understanding of how transformative being involved in theater experience can be, and being able to tell a story or to hear portions of your story performed back to you. Just how validating it is and how it creates, you know, the right to speech. So I would assume, I haven't actually talked to him in a while. I would assume that he carried that knowledge into this project. As far as the therapy goes, those were therapists who agreed, some of them for very low wages, some for free. I mean, there were a number of, he did tell me that there were a number of refugees with psychological training who volunteered their services with this group. And that was separate from the rehearsal process. I don't know to what extent Omar Al-Sada or any of the theater practitioners were involved in shaping those therapeutic services. When I say that, you know, going forward they want to provide additional therapeutic services, that's the information that the British organization that funded this project has announced on their webpage, that going forward they want to make therapy a major part of their future theater projects. Well, listen, we'll make this one last.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, good comment. No, I'm just interested in the dramaturgical gesture of using ancient Greece to to kind of talk about trauma. I mean, Jill knows this in Peru, a group called Yuachkani used an Antigona to talk about loss as well. And it's interesting that in both Antigona, which is a one-woman show, also masculinity in a way haunts. That is, masculinity is present by its absence, not the lost brother or the lost husband. But my question is, what do you think is being produced by this gesture towards ancient Greece? Is it about being legible to an international, read Western audience?
Yeah.
Is it about saying this is not about Syria, it's about the human condition?
Well, so, you know, two Brits come up with this idea. A British filmmaker and a British writer come up with this idea. The first thing I want to go to the Zaatari refugee camp. They don't realize that the vast majority of Syrians are in fact in Amman. They're not in the camps, they've just integrated into the city. And but we're going to go there, we're going to do a Trojan Women. And you can see where, you can understand the logic. You know, like this is a story of, you know, the East, of the destruction of the East. It's a story about, you know, the pain of women. And their idea was just to stage the Trojan Women. But they don't speak Arabic. So they ask around who should they get to direct it. And the obvious choice is Omar Al-Saba, who's, you know, one of the really great young directors in Syria. And he's worked extensively. He's worked in prisons. He's worked in the countryside. He's worked in children's theater, and he's continuing to make theater in Damascus in the midst of the civil war. So someone contacts him. He contacts the, you know, all of your students, right? All and your scenographer in the setting.
I have another information.
Sure, please.
This, the Trojan Woman, was in the beginning the project of Marias.
Really?
Yes. She has been working on this project on the Trojan Woman before.
Right.
She was working on it to have kind of Syrian version of Trojan Woman, you know, but she hasn't, she doesn't have in mind that they are going to do it with refugee. That was before. And then when the British, these producers came, it's her who
convinced them to
not convinced, but suggest that. That's what I know.
How?
Are you sure of your story?
No.
So
the British producers.
Yeah. And now, and tonight is the opening of another show in Beirut, in Masrah al-Madina in Beirut, made by Muhammad Attar,
okay.
The same group. It's Antigone.
Okay.
Antigone, Syria.
Antigone
of Syria, yeah, tonight is the opening show.
Yeah.
And with the woman refugee in Lebanon.
The Syrian
woman refugee.
Masrah al-Madina is the premier theater in Beirut. It's an, with multiple stages in an absolutely gorgeous space. Whereas other theaters are, you know, converted to cinema halls, this is a really beautiful.
But his point is well taken, though, is that to be appealing to more Western audiences, do you think?
Yeah.
Or it's just Greek and
it's
all.
I mean, I can
tell why.
I don't know, is the answer.
Can I break in here just a little bit of theater history? La Mama, which is very close to here, had an amazing production of the Trojan Women.
Yeah.
I think it was 30 years ago, Andre Serban was the director, and it was an absolutely astonishing. And I don't know whether it was ever actually filmed, but it would be fascinating to compare the two.
Right.
So I just wanted to mention that. You've seen this
film. I did. This way was some music.
I think it was in this way.
Oh, really?
You've seen it.
Yeah.
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 Right.
And then also the Open Theater. which you probably know about, which has been actually involved since the 60s and offshoot. It's been off from the Living Theater doing political theater. There was something called the Brink.
Yeah, yes, there were.
Yeah. I'm mentioning some of these things because we do have quite a history of off-Broadway political participatory theater before Go Out.
Yeah.
Just what I've mentioned.
It goes back to this observation before that, you know, there's theater exists on these different continuums. It's always engaging the political, it's always engaging the personal. But that really is a great place to end. Thank you. And thank you for staying the whole time. And I have these flyers there about my book. The flyer that the book is 50% off. And thanks to NYUAD for giving me the space and letting me go on.